This is a sine wave signal that consists of many frequencies. I pass it through a mystery box, which gives away an altered signal. Can you guess what's in the box? If you think it is a low-pass filter, then you're right. But how does a low-pass filter, or LPF, change this signal? We will understand this by diving into the Fourier analysis of LPF, and we will also discuss how to construct the altered signal. We start with a flat frequency response curve. Draw a line at the cutoff frequency, omega c. To the right of the vertical line, the response curve is bent downwards. Therefore, for the signal with frequency lower than the cutoff frequency, its amplitude remains quite the same. On the other hand, the signal with higher frequency gets attenuated. In this video, I will use the most basic example, the RC low-pass filter. This is the simplest realization of LPF that anyone can find. Of course, it has its own frequency response. To visualize it, we have to go through several steps first. The frequency response is complex valued, so I am going to rewrite it in polar form. The complex magnitude is the magnitude response, while the power of the exponential is the phase response. Let us discuss the magnitude response first and phase response later. It is pretty straightforward to write the magnitude and draw the corresponding plot. Do you notice that this plot looks different from the one I used earlier? This one is drawn on the linear scale, while the earlier on the logarithmic scale. The latter is more famously known as Bode plot. It is more convenient because it can easily accommodate frequencies to the order of thousands or tens of thousands. Sketching a Bode plot is not so difficult. For the x-axis, take the logarithm of the frequency omega and put the result as the axis label. For the y-axis, take the logarithm of the magnitude response, multiply it by 20, and use the result for the axis label. It has the unit of decibel, which is more widely used than the linear scale. What is so unique about the cutoff frequency? To its left, the gain curve is flat. The value of the gain in this range is named passband gain. By increasing the frequency, eventually we reach the cutoff frequency. Here, the gain is 3 decibels lower than that of the passband gain. This is a natural consequence from the mathematical expression. The gain in linear scale is equal to 1 over the square root of 2. In terms of percentage, it translates to 70.7% of the passband gain. In decibel scale, it is equivalent to minus 3 decibels. How steep is the declining slope? This is very close to a straight line, so just draw horizontal and vertical lines from the curve and measure the slope inclination. For a frequency multiple of 10, the gain decreases by minus 20 decibels. For higher order filter, it can be steeper. Now it's time to discuss the phase response. We get back to the frequency response in polar form and take the angle or phase. It is characterized by an inverse tangent, and I'd love to visualize it. We have two horizontal asymptotes, one at plus 90 degrees and another at negative 90 degrees. This asymptote implies that the phase shift cannot exceed 90 degrees. The linear scale is good enough, but I'd like to switch to logarithmic scale. For this simple LPF, there is no need to apply logarithmic scaling to the y-axis because the phase shift does not reach the order of thousands of degrees. Therefore, the logarithmic scale only applies to x-axis. How does the phase response affect the sinusoidal input? For the time being, we ignore the change in signal amplitude. The output is also a sinusoidal signal, but with a negative phase shift. This negative phase shift is more commonly known as the phase lag. If the phase shift were positive, it would be a phase lead. Over the increase in frequency, the phase lag becomes larger and larger. Do you still remember the signal from the beginning of the video? I'll dissect this to its frequency components. Their frequencies in radians per second are 10, 50, 100, 500, 1000, 2000, and 5000. This is the Fourier series of the input signal. Each frequency has equal amplitude, 20 decibels. This signal will be the input for a first-order RC low-pass filter with cutoff frequency at 500 radians per second. Let's see what happens to each frequency. In terms of magnitude, the first three frequencies can pass through the filter with only little change. The signal at the cutoff frequency gets attenuated by 3 decibels. Furthermore, the higher frequencies get stronger attenuation. In terms of phase, each frequency gets its own phase lag. The higher the frequency, the larger the phase lag. One last step before signal reconstruction is converting the amplitude scale from dB to linear scale. The formula is simple. Here's how to understand it. Divide the dB value by 20, then use the result as the power of 10. Apply the same procedure to the amplitude of each harmonic to convert them into linear scale. They are displayed in the table. The phase lags do not need any modification. They are written in degrees instead of radians for convenience. With the knowledge of magnitude and phase change, we can construct the output signal. I'm writing down the sine function first. Then, arrange the amplitude and phase of each signal accordingly. This step needs a bit patience and attention. The output signal is simply the summation from all individual signals. I hope it is satisfying to be able to construct the output by getting into this level of detail. Don't forget to hit that subscribe button, so you will be always stay tuned to the same frequency as ours. What do you think about this video? Let me know in the comment section. If you feel that this video can help your friends to understand the topic, share it to them. Thank you, and see you next time.